Well, as I mentioned at the beginning of the show, I'm expecting a guest around, oh, I don't know, 4:30 or so. And his name is K.C. Marsh. He's the son of the great tenor saxophonist Warne Marsh. And there's so much to play that I thought I'd sneak in a little bit of Warne before K.C. gets here. Warne Marsh, who is paired in most people's minds with Lee Konitz, and they both studied with Lenny Tristano, who was rather a mentor plus, I would say, actually, almost a Svengali-like figure. And but they came up with some very wonderful stuff. This, however, is something from 1982 and a quartet date that Warren did for the Crisscross label called Star Highs, also featuring Hank Jones on piano, George Mraz on bass, and Mel Lewis on drums. And this is the Charlie Parker tune, Moose the Mooch. Good morning. It's 24 minutes after 4 o'clock, and my guest has arrived. He is K.C. Marsh, the son of the great tenor saxophonist Warne Marsh. K.C., how you doing?
Doing pretty good.
Good. The mic is working. I chose the right one.
All right, then.
And K.C. has a film that he's been working on for quite some time. It's now in post-production, called An Improvised Life, about his father. And, well, how are things going with that?
Things are going good. You know, we're doing it's called a Seed and Spark fundraiser at seedandspark.com, and raising funds for post-production. But it's going really well. We've been getting the word out. One of the exciting things was I was at the premiere for the jazz film Lowdown about Joe Albany.
Wonderful film.
Yeah, I really, really loved that film. We had met the director at Sundance, and I started talking to the editor, who I'd met previously. He's like, you know, I think you really need someone who knows jazz, man. I'd really like to take a look at your film. And so he came on board after a short conversation. So we're very excited that he's working with us. Michael Saya, very cool guy, lives in New York. So we're going to do it's going to be a bi-coastal production.
I see. Yeah. I see. Now, the film itself, it's not necessarily just a biography of your father, so to speak, but it's a lot of it is your growing up and your interaction with your father, is it not?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I say that one of the themes is I call it the price of genius, but it's a little bit like, I liken our childhood to being like army brats, right? I call us jazz babies, following dad around, and dad off doing his music and the family doing their thing. So there's a lot of perspective of it being through my eyes and through the family's eyes, as well as being, I would say, a loving tribute to, an unsung jazz great, you know.
Indeed. And it must have been difficult at times because he was so obsessed with music. I mean, he was one of these people who would practice 8 hours a day without even blinking.
Oh, yeah, yeah. One of the times that I remember that most clearly is when we lived in Connecticut, and he had a studio in New York, famously, that a lot of people studied with him there. And he was in New York, like, usually 4 out of 7 days a week. We'd come back to Connecticut, and he would spend most of those days practicing, you know.
Right.
A day where I could get my dad to take me to the mall or something sort of pedestrian like that, it was like a holiday. That was amazing, you know.
And we must also get to your family history, which is absolutely fascinating because it coincides with the birth of the movies. And why don't you explain? Your grandfather was a famous cinematographer.
Yeah, Oliver Tenbrock Marsh. And if you look him up on IMDb, you'll see he's got about 150 movies to his credits, give or take. He was Jeanette McDonald's favorite cameraman. You know, if they knew how to light you, they became your new best friend.
Right.
And it's a joke. My uncle, who also got into cinematography, used to talk about, you know. And he did films like San Francisco, Tale of Two Cities, After the Thin Man, and just the list goes on and on. He won an Academy Award for color cinematography on Sweethearts. I think that was like 1932. He's featured in a documentary oh, I forget it was. It's basically a documentary. It goes something, A Visions of Light, I think it's called. That's about cinematographers. So he was quite successful. I think he has a star on Hollywood Boulevard, but one of his kin, my great aunt Mae Marsh, who was my dad's aunt, has a, you know, a star on the Hollywood
Sure,
Walk of Fame.
One of the great cast of characters from the D.W. Griffith.
Oh yes,
films,
yeah, and she started off. I don't know if you know. Her first film was Birth of a Nation.
That's right.
Yeah, she was like he was the little girl, I think, that gets scared, you know, and it gets, you know. There's a African-American guy who, I don't know, I forget the sequence, but basically she's the little girl who runs away and gets scared, or I think, you know. So, yeah, she started early.
Well, let's play a little music, and we have so much to talk about as well and so much to play, and I want to start with some of his early stuff from with Lenny Tristano, and of course, Lenny was his mentor.
Yeah,
and perhaps
dear
even
friend.
More.
We were just talking about this before we started, about how my grandfather Oliver died at 48 years old, and I think he was at the commissary at MGM. And so my dad was only 11, so he lost his dad early. And I would say that, I don't know if Lenny was a father figure, but he was like family. He was very, very dear to my father. Yeah.
And your father got in touch with Lenny Tristano after he was in the Army. He was in the Army in Virginia,
right.
I believe, and then later in New Jersey. He had asked for a transfer to get close to New York, because that was where everything was happening. It was the height of the bebop era.
Yep.
And he used to go see Charlie Parker all the time. And
and
someone, was it Ted Brown who hooked him up with Lenny?
That sounds right. I'd have to check my facts on that one. But yeah,
I think
Ted
Brown was teaching. I mean, was a student of Lenny's at the time.
And
showed him some letters. I was just sort of rereading the biography, which is excellent, by Safford Chamberlain.
Yep.
Called An Unsung Cat, all about Warne Marsh. And he talks about how Warne had actually read some letters from Lenny to Ted Brown.
Right.
And they were basically lessons.
Yeah.
And Warne read them and saw that he would be a perfect fit. And but that was a whole strange little cell that Lenny had. He was not only a father figure, but they were all into psychoanalysis and Wilhelm Reich, and that sort of furthered the father figure emphasis.
Yeah, it seems like it did, and there were certainly I call it a clique, if you will, but there were some people that were just very dedicated to Lenny, you know, and what he had to offer as a teacher and a mentor. But I always appreciated that my dad, you know, as much as he deeply loved Lenny, I mean, he still did his own thing. You know what I mean?
Right.
But also, I think he took away from Lenny that idea of like not compromising your music.
Exactly.
And so I think that in a lot of ways that was maybe a limiting factor in my dad's career. You
Absolutely.
Know? He just wouldn't play any old gig.
It was kind of self-defeating, because there were years where he didn't record at all, and he didn't really care, because he was just trying to find the right way to do it.
Yeah, you know, I think a modern equivalent of that is, I think when I was growing up, when Branford Marsalis started playing with Sting, right? And I understand, I don't know this for a fact, but I understand that, you know, he got some flack for that, you know, sort of a rock star and this jazz musician. And that's the kind of thing that I think that crowd would pick on you for, if you went off and you did something too commercial or too whatever.
Sure.
But, you know, people, you got to play and enjoy yourself and raise families and all those things. But he put music first, always.
And it's also, I think, amazing the rapport that that the two principal students of Lenny Tristano had together, Lee Konitz and Warne Marsh. I'm talking musically, not necessarily personally, because I understand they had some problems here and there. But the way they played in unison.
Yeah,
and
so magical.
The counterpoint was amazing, and we're going to get to some music to describe just what we're talking about. We'll start with one of the very early sessions, maybe the first session on Prestige.
Yeah.
In fact, it wasn't even known as Prestige in those days. It was known as New Jazz.
Mm.
And this is a tune written by your father based on the chord changes to Cherokee called Marshmallow. And the group here, in addition to Lenny Tristano on piano and Lee Konitz on alto and Warne Marsh on tenor, we have, let's see here, Billy Bauer, I believe. Yes. No, Sal Mosca on piano, Arnold Fishkin on bass, and Denzel Best on drums. Mm-hmm. And we'll follow that with a couple things from Lenny's Capitol sides.
Yeah, I love those.
There's this one tune called Wow.
Yeah.
Which perfectly describes the bridge, actually. The bridge is famous because of the double timing, but the precision is just amazing. Yeah. And then also from this session was the very first free jazz recording.
Right.
Although it sounds a bit quaint these days.
Mm-hmm.
But nothing was preordained or prearranged except for who would come in when.
Right.
And it was just all off the top of the head. But, anyway, I'm through talking for the moment.
All right.
Let's get to first up Marshmallow and then Wow. I Can't Get Started, as performed by Lee Konitz on alto saxophone, Warne Marsh on tenor, and Billy Bauer on guitar, as we continue our feature on Warne Marsh this morning with Casey Marsh, who is sitting across from me and promoting his film, and we will do so momentarily. All right, Casey, tell me a little more about the film, and also I know that you're in post-production now.
Yes.
But if people listening to this would like to contribute to the final, you're on the last leg here.
Yeah.
How does one do so?
Well, there's a website called Seed and Spark. That's just Seed like Johnny Appleseed and Spark like spark plug, all spelled out, Seed and Spark. You go to the studio section or just search for Warne Marsh, Warne, W-A-R-N-E, famously misspelled often.
Right.
Or just type in Marsh and you'll find the film Warne Marsh, An Improvised Life. And, you know, we're running the fundraiser through the 26th of December. So we've got a little bit of time left. Tell a friend, and you know, people can jump in. It's been a great adventure, and it's been amazing seeing how many supporters. The Facebook fan page that we run to has gotten an additional 600 fans just in the last 2 or 3 weeks.
That's great. That's
great.
Yeah. Well, it's Christmas, folks. Just keep that in mind.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
And let's see. I wanted to play something next. This is from a recording called Lee Konitz Meets Jimmy Giuffre. And it's kind of an odd recording in the sense that it's Giuffre arrangements for five saxophones, which is kind of reminiscent of Super Sax, the
mm-hmm.
group that your father was famously in, which we will get to perhaps after this cut. But I wanted to play this cut in particular. It's a version of When Your Lover Has Gone. Lee takes the first solo, and then your father comes in. And his entrance just cracks me up because it reminds me of Kramer coming through the door to Jerry's apartment,
yes.
know, with his elbows out and coming in sideways.
I can't wait to hear this because I don't know this track.
Yeah.
I'm excited.
So here 'tis, and then... Well, we'll figure out something to do after that. When Your Lover Has Gone. That is the group known as Super Sax. And Warne Marsh was certainly a part of that. It was five saxophones in four-part harmony with the top and the bottom playing the same note, I guess.
Yeah.
And what we heard was Charlie Parker's Ornithology with Frank Rossellino on trombone, just a monster trombone player. And, of course, Warne Marsh on tenor and Lou Levy there on piano. Now, tell me what sort of interactions your father had with Charlie Parker, if any?
You know, I remember he played with him as a young kid, and I probably won't have all my facts straight, so forgive me here, but I know that there's a recording where he plays with him. And
wow,
that,
I didn't know that.
And I believe so. I thought he played with him quite young. And I know that Charlie Parker famously was sitting with Lenny and watching him play. And he sort of tapped him on the shoulder and said, "Who's that?" And he said, "Oh, that's Warne Marsh." Lenny told Charlie Parker that. And yeah. Charlie Parker said, "That kid's got it." You know,
right.
That was a famous quote. And then I just posted on the Seed and Spark website a little clip of Gary Foster telling a story about how, for whatever reason, my dad was sitting in on something, and he was sitting with Charlie Parker, and Charlie Parker taught him a tune that my dad taught Gary, and the way to play it. And someone was trying to correct Gary on how to play it. And he's like, "Well, I learned it from Warne Marsh, who learned it from Charlie Parker. So I'll stick to that."
And also, weren't you named after Charlie Parker's tune, KC Blues?
Yes, absolutely. Well, and where he's from too, he's born in Kansas City. So I was intended to be K period C period Marsh for Kansas City Marsh, so that I would be KC. The mythology goes, my mom tells me that some mean nurse looked at that. She'd had a C-section and was still kind of drugged up and had written K period C period in honor of what my dad intended. And she crossed it out and wrote C-A-S-E-Y and said, "You can't spell it like that." So I'm legally C-A-S-E-Y. My brother's actually Jason Parker Marsh.
Oh, is that right?
So his stuck, mine didn't. So I go by KC all the time.
And your dad wrote a tune for you, actually. I have it here somewhere. KC initially?
Initially KC. Yes. Yes, exactly. Yeah, I love that. He did one for me, my brother, and my mom.
I see.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to turn next to something we spoke about earlier. This is a recording that he made with Joe Albany, although I don't think it was intended to be released. I mean, it sounds like a rehearsal session. It's just those two along with Bob Whitlock on bass.
Yeah.
And in fact, I think it was recorded at Bob Whitlock's apartment.
Yeah, likely.
And there's a wonderful version of Body and Soul here, which we're going to get to. It sort of starts off in mid-bridge, which is why I would obviously think they wouldn't have released this.
Right.
You know, at the time, although it did come out on Riverside. And I think they put it out because the music was just so outstanding that despite the flaws, it was a must hear.
Yeah.
And here we will. This is Body and Soul.
Where can you be?
That was the Norwegian singer Karen Krogh, along with Warne Marsh on tenor saxophone and Red Mitchell on bass for Loverman. And as we were talking before, Casey, that's probably the only time that Warne, at least to my knowledge, recorded with a vocalist.
I believe that is correct.
Yeah. We heard Warne with Red Mitchell before that as well. This is from a live recording in Sweden, just a duet record. The LP is called Hot House, and we heard Tea for Two. And we began with Body and Soul, Joe Albany on piano with Warne Marsh and Bob Whitlock on bass. And once again, if you haven't seen the movie Lowdown, it's a wonderful movie. It's actually the book I read as well. It's a memoir by his daughter about growing up in the seedier parts of Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And but you say the editor of that film is now your editor.
Yes, we were very excited about it. I saw him at the premiere, L.A. premiere. I got invited to that, having met the director. We got to talking, and he's like, "Yeah, you." He says, "I think I really want to talk to you about your film and take a look at that footage and work on that." And so I've been, we had a few conversations and we're working together. It's great. I'm getting all the footage ready prepared for him to ship it over. He's in New York. I'm in L.A., so, and I'm very excited. He's very enthusiastic about it.
How long have you been preparing this film?
Over 4 years, but I was, you know, I forget that over 10 years ago, I started to try to do this, you know, back when, you know, video was on tape and, you know, I have some old interviews of my mom that I was trying to do. I didn't really know what I was doing at the time. I was just making it up as I went. But, you know, this last effort for what I am now calling Warne Marsh and Improvised Life has been about 4 years.
But, I see.
You know, I've always wanted to do something about my dad ever since, you know, ever since he passed away.
Yes, and passing away under rather shocking circumstances.
Yeah, yeah, on stage, playing out of nowhere. He has a heart attack on stage in the middle of a song at Dante's in North Hollywood.
And sort of against doctor's orders, wasn't it, as I understand?
Yeah, I came to find out that he had was not really sharing that he had had some heart problems before, hadn't really, you know, wasn't supposed to be playing. He sort of did everything he wasn't supposed to be doing and continued playing and went out playing.
Yes, excess in moderation has always been my motto.
Exactly.
Anyway, let's turn to, we have a very short time here to go, but let's turn to a couple of things. I wanted to play something from Claire Fisher, actually, in a recording with your father. And we'll hear solos by Warne Marsh and also Conti Condoli on trumpet for something that Claire Fisher wrote. It's called Miles Behind. Once again, Warne Marsh. This one goes back a ways, 1957. The original title, Music for Prancing. And it's got some sort of hipster with a weird expression on his face.
Yeah, I love that album.
Yeah. Ronnie Ball was the pianist, Red Mitchell on bass, and Stan Levy on drums. And we've been talking to K.C. Marsh this morning in so that we can talk about this movie that's coming out called An Improvised Life that K.C. has been working on for some time. And K.C., why don't you tell them where they can find the information.
Well, you know, the fundraiser's up at seedandspark.com, but if you just go to google.com and search for Warne Marsh and Improvised Life, the first thing that'll come up is our Facebook page, which has all the information about the fundraiser and links. But you will also, if you just Google that on the internet, you know, a little ways down, you'll see a seedandspark.com website. That is the actual fundraiser. Yeah, it's great. I mean, we're offering up, I mean, if people want to help produce it, you know, we'll give you producer level credits. And if you want to jump in and really help.
That's right. You have
cement a piece of jazz history.
What are the sort of things that you're looking, the holes that you're trying to fill?
Well, you know, we're raising funds to pay for all the various costs of post-production. It's like, I don't want my editor working for free. I mean, he's going to work on this regardless, but there's going to be a lot of costs associated with that. And we're trying to encourage people to contribute with offering certain things at certain levels. We've got the original print of the painting that Charles Kaufman did of my dad. Oh. He's going to autograph some of those. John Petrucelli did a transcription of the entire unissued Copenhagen album, which was a lot of work, and he offered up about 20 copies of those.
One of my favorites, by the way. I just love that record.
Yeah. So we're trying to encourage people to look at it as being a part of making the film. You know, we're not giving away a lot of stuff, but we do have some, and be a part of a really wonderful document of jazz history. And also, I just want to briefly mention that, you know, I realized in doing this these interviews that we were capturing a part of jazz history that, you know, so those guys are going to be gone soon. I mean, a lot of these guys are in their 80s, and there's a lot of really wonderful stories that they had to share, and I felt very, very privileged to be able to capture that.
Well, I feel very privileged that you're here, K.C., to talk about all this stuff, because Warne Marsh is one of my absolute favorites, and somebody who deserves a lot more recognition. In fact, when I think of the pantheon of tenor players, you know, I think of the big five, first of all. You got your Lester Young, Coleman Hawkins, Ben Webster. You got Sonny Rollins and John Coltrane. Warren is the next tier.
Yeah.
In my mind. You know, I would say he's one of the top ten. This is my own personal opinion and taste, but I just thought he was just fabulous. So thank you very much for coming this morning.
Thank you.
And let me tell all you listeners out there that, as if you didn't know,